Happy New Year's, guys, and with the new year comes World Carnivore Month of January. Now, what can you expect from going on the carnivore diet for a period of a month? And this depends greatly on what type of carnivore diet you are following. Obviously, there are drastic differences and levels, so to speak, of how strictly you can follow a carnivore diet. There are some people that only eat beef, salt, and water. And there are other people who indulge in bacon every morning, eggs, dairy products. And we'll kind of go over the pros and cons of each of these options. First, we just want to note the two main benefits of this diet that you could hypothetically achieve. The first one being the removal of inflammation from your diet. This is enough to improve most people's lives to the point where they don't really question how to improve their diet any further. But this is also difficult to achieve for some people that are still incorporating problem foods. For some people it's eggs, for some it's bacon, for some it's cheese, for one reason or another. The second element that you can seek to achieve on a carnivore diet is the increase in nutrient density. And unfortunately, most people fall short on this, partly because of the food quality and partially because of the parts of the animal that they choose to consume. So now that you have an idea of what to expect from the carnivore diet and the various degrees that you can follow it, let's take a look at what's in my fridge for World Carnivore Month before we elaborate further. All right, so for those of you guys that haven't seen my setup, I have a dehumidifier that I constantly run and a fan to keep the air circulating. Now, up here are some steak I'm dry aging that I'm probably gonna actually serve for my family, but the main source of calories that I've been consuming lately. So what I've been eating for the most part is three things. I have some New York strip steaks from Australia here. Marbling isn't too great, but there's a decent fat cap. I have some short ribs that are grass-fed from North Carolina. These are incredibly fatty. I really love these as a food because I don't really have to add any fat to that or anything. And here I have some beef suet from a local farm that I can just substitute in meals. In this drawer here, I have some very freshly ground meat from a local farm. And a lot of you guys say don't eat ground meat when you have histamine problems, but this is literally as fresh as you can get. So for me, this is a great source of nutrition that I don't really have to worry about reacting to for the most part. But that's really all I have right now. It's pretty simple. We'll go upstairs and take a look at the raw butter, but for the most part, you know, by keeping the meat high quality grass-fed, we're increasing the nutrient density. We have cuts of meat that are very fatty, and for the cuts of meat that aren't fatty, we can substitute some fat to it.
So in the video I made yesterday, I clarified some raw butter, and right now I'm using that as sort of a supplementary fat source for the meat that does not have enough fat on it. Some of you guys might be thinking, Frank, don't you usually consume more organ meats? Yes, but a lot of the nutrient density that is achieved is actually through consistent high levels of quality fat consumption. Yes, you might be able to front load some vitamin A and a decent amount of vitamin K2 from consuming liver. You might be able to get a decent amount of omega-3s if you incorporate fish into your diet every day. But the real core of any carnivore diet and the real way to maintain nutrient density, low levels of inflammation, is really just to make sure all of the food is high quality and that you're getting enough fat. You know, the difference between this butter and the butter that you buy in the supermarket could literally be 5 to 10-fold the amount of vitamins. So that's the main thing to take away here, is that the food quality will make or break your success in regards to optimizing the nutrient density of your carnivore diet. Now, this ties in directly to how the animal is raised. In order for the meat to be high quality, the animal has to be grass-fed, ideally grass-finished, on high quality summer pasture. Obviously, that is not practical at all parts of the year, but there is definitely a lot we can do to try to optimize our nutrient intake at all points. Now, yes, there are some people that do have bacon and eggs for breakfast and various high omega-6 meats, but we can safely say there are two drastic ends of this diet and that you kind of want to be somewhere in the middle in the very least. You know, on my end, you might have someone who has only grass-fed meat, very high-quality fatty meats, organ meats, high-quality wild-caught fish, eggs straight from the farm, raw butter from a local farm. You could have someone doing everything as perfectly as possible, and what that person will do is remove all inflammation from their diet and optimize nutrient density. The diet can really go wrong in two major ways. You can consume foods that are very high in omega-6 fats, such as pork, chicken, poorly raised meats, or you could just consume too many processed meats with nitrates, sugar, spices, seasonings. And the problem with those is partially the palatability and also partially histamine. So, you know, the baseline in the middle might be something along the lines of just grain-fed beef. And even grain-fed beef is probably leaning more towards the diet that I follow. So I think a good metric here is on the best end, you have someone consuming only high-quality nutrient-dense foods and nothing they're allergic to. Like if they're allergic to eggs or dairy, they don't have them in the diet. A good middle ground might be someone that's only consuming grain-fed beef. You know, they might not be incorporating organ meats and nutrient-dense animal foods, but at least they're not consuming very high omega-6 inflammatory foods as a large portion of their calories. And on the other end of the spectrum, you might have someone that's consuming just commercial tons of bacon, sausages, pork, chicken, eggs that are, you know, grain-fed, high omega-6. And by all means, can that diet work for some people? Yes, but there are drastic differences between these three diets. And if you made the switch from, you know, that all processed meat diet to an only beef diet, you would feel drastically better. Same thing from going from that all beef diet to all high quality food diet. The only thing is that it is so much more difficult to go from point B to point C than it is to go from point A to point B. It's very easy to just consume grain-fed beef and drop those processed foods. The problem is sourcing and getting high quality grass-fed animal products that are fatty enough. So hopefully this gives you guys some context to the various degrees that someone can follow a carnivore diet. And even on that end of the spectrum that I'm at, you have some people that consume only raw foods, you have some people that do some very, very extreme versions of the diet. But overall, hopefully this gives you guys an idea of what I've been doing recently and what I am striving to achieve. I've been kind of laying off the liver a bit lately and the fish. I've noticed that the linoleic and linolenic acid content is substantially high enough in the meat that I'm eating, and I haven't really been craving liver that much. Maybe I'll get some duck liver because I enjoy it so much, but for the most part, you don't really have to be front-loading vitamin A at all points of the year, especially now that I'm not getting as much sun as I used to. So thank you guys for watching. If you guys have any questions about where I source this food, I do usually go to local meat purveyors. If you are in the New York City area, I might be able to help you out. If you guys would like to support the channel, please subscribe and share the video. If you guys want to check out my Amazon shop, I didn't show you guys my, I have a bunch of salts over here. You guys can season your meat however you want on the carnivore diet. Most people usually only stick to salt. Two of my favorite salts are any gray Celtic salt and Fleur de Sel de Gouran, which is a DOC, a very famous French salt. These are the two best salts that I have ever tasted. I've worked in quite a few kitchens and they're definitely up there with the best. But if you guys do want to check out my Amazon shop, I do have those salts on there. If you guys want to go on my Patreon, I do have an interesting story about me. I'm on Twitter, I'm on Instagram. You guys can reach out to me one-on-one for consultations regarding diet, overall health, fitness, what type of water you're drinking, maybe even food sourcing. Maybe you want some help with food sourcing and figuring out, you know, where you can order meat, how to obtain certain foods. Feel free to send me an email, frankatofano@gmail.com, or contact me through the form on my website. All that stuff is in the description, guys. I hope some of you do try World Carnivore Month that maybe aren't trying it. And if not, I hope you at least combat some of the veganuary people. I didn't want to mention that at the beginning of the video because I think veganuary is a bit more catchy than World Carnivore Month. But what are you going to do? Again, thank you guys for watching the video. Enjoy the new year, and I'm looking forward to what 2019 has in store for the carnivore diet.